one thing that financiers know and sort of have exposure to that a lot of academic economists, probably, you know, probably the overwhelming majority of academic economists don't, is actual exposure to actual financial markets. They actually see how this shit works, right? And anybody who's actually watched this shit happening for more than about 8.5 minutes will just tell you immediately that pretty much every orthodox economics textbook that's assigned you in your undergraduate economics courses or your graduate ones is just sheerest bullshit. Imagine I invented something I just called the, you know, the blind spaghetti monster, and then I just started building a discipline around it. And then, you know, for decades and decades, people just keep talking about the blind spaghetti monster without ever actually looking to see whether it could be found, any, you know, what, even asking what the hell it was.
This is the MMT Podcast with Patricia Pino and Christian Riley. Hi, I'm Christian Riley, and welcome to the Modern Monetary Theory Podcast. You can find us on Twitter at MMT Podcast, and you can support the show by going to patreon.com/MMT Podcast. For as little as a dollar a month, you can get early access to all our episodes and patron-only episodes. A big thank you to all our supporters so far. At the beginning there, you heard our guest this week, Professor of Law, Robert Hockett. And in a moment, we're going to be talking to him about his roots as a scholar, about the man he describes as the most important economist you've never heard of, and about his work on digitizing the dollar. If you're new to MMT, you might want to check out our first three episodes, which I've linked to in the show notes, where me and Patricia lay out the basics in an easy-to-understand way. But if you want to dive in here, a big theme is something you pretty much know intuitively, that money is a human creation rather than a scarce natural resource, and that the creation of what we call money happens in our current time and place at the will of, or with the permission of, government. To paraphrase best-selling author and economist Professor Stephanie Kelton, if we look operationally at how government finance actually works, we discover that there's really only one way for a government to pay for things. All government spending is indeed already and only ever paid for with new money creation. There's no other way for it to work. So if you live in a country with a government that issues its own currency, that currency is a policy tool for moving resources around. And for the issuer, your government, there is no shortage of it. And when we don't understand that, here in the UK, for instance, we fall prey to politicians who tell us they've run out of money to feed hungry schoolchildren as they light cigars with flaming £50 notes. That's the politicians lighting the cigars there, not the schoolchildren, although the next big economic stimulus idea could well be cigar vouchers for kids, depending on which company the next person to have an extramarital affair with the Prime Minister works for. In this interview, you'll hear Robert talk about the importance of journalist and mathematician turned economist Knut Wicksell, who Robert considers a father to the Austrian, Keynesian and post-Keynesian schools of thought, in addition to the Stockholm school with which he is usually associated. Just to add, in my non-professorial point of view, it may seem at first glance that MMT differs from Wicksell in his ideas about the natural rate of interest. But as I understand Professor Hockett's subsequent commentary about his recent article on Wicksell, it's his view that Wicksell has suffered a fate at the hands of Wicksellians similar to the fate that Keynes suffered at the hands of Keynesians. Robert argues that Wicksell's intended natural rate is just the lowest rate consistent with the real resource constraint that MMTers will be familiar with. This stems from his Böhm-Bawerkian account of capital. Putting that to one side, certainly the functioning of endogenous money or bank-extended credit, which Wicksell codified based on his experience as a close observer of real financial markets and his academic background in mathematics, is something that MMT proponents need to get to grips with sooner or later. You can listen to our episode 43 with Sam Levy for more on endogenous money, but I'll give you a quick overview. I'm going to talk about the UK, but this generalizes to all countries with currency issuing governments, such as the US, Japan, Canada, or Australia. When you take out, say, a £1,000 loan at a commercial bank, you write a £1,000 IOU to the bank. And your promise to pay £1,000 to the bank in the future can be considered your own £1,000 banknote from the bank of you. And you swap your £1,000 IOU for the bank's £1,000 worth of bank credit. And you do this because your IOU is not accepted in the places where you want to transact, but bank credit is. Why is that? Because the bank has been authorized by the government through law to issue credit money, and you haven't. Hence, as Warren Mosler, the founder of MMT, puts it, when commercial banks create bank credit, they are acting as agents of government. It's also worth noting that when the level of bank credit goes up, the level of private sector debt increases by the same amount as the loan, and these two things net to zero. So in the lending process, no net financial assets are added to the private sector. Whereas when governments spend more than they collect in taxes, in other words, when they run a deficit, that deficit does create net financial assets for the private sector. And the difference between private sector debt and what is misleadingly called government debt couldn't be more stark. When currency-issuing governments issue so-called debt, what's happening in the real world, again sticking with the UK, is that the government is exchanging bonds, which are interest-bearing pounds, for non-interest-bearing pounds of the bond purchaser. The bond and the pounds that are used to buy the bond can both be thought of as money. And so all that's happening is that pounds are being moved from a current account to a savings account at the Bank of England. And when the bond matures, the pounds are shifted back to the current account again. All of this is bookkeeping done with keystrokes. And as the issuer of pounds, the UK government can never involuntarily default on promises to pay pounds. And you can listen to our episodes 30 and 31 with Dr. Stephen Hale for more detail on this. For non-issuers of pounds, i.e. you and me, the private sector, we can default on our loans. And so, as private sector debt increases, the financial system moves from stability to fragility. And anyone who is old enough to remember 2008 will have an insight into the real-world consequences of this. So, to recap, endogenous money theory contains the by now relatively uncontroversial insight that banks are not intermediaries lending out money that savers have deposited with them, but rather they create new money when they lend. So loans create deposits, not the other way around. But an increase in bank credit money is matched by an increase in private sector debt. And so bank lending adds no net financial assets to the private sector. And this is different to when governments spend more than they tax, which does add net financial assets to the private sector. Banks can lend money into existence because they've been granted a legal franchise to do this by government. So this is just me, but I find it helpful to think of government spending as spending new pounds into existence and commercial bank lending as the government lending new money into existence through a designated agent. This is my interpretation based on the reading of and conversations with economists that we've done over the last few years. And if you like, you can check my reasoning by listening to the episodes I've linked to in the show notes. Also in the show notes, I've linked to some great articles and papers by Robert, and also to where you can get your hands on his two most recent books. And as ever, there's a link to where you can support this podcast financially via patreon.com/mmtpodcast. Support starts at $1 a month, which is 77 British pence at the time of recording. And no matter what level of support you give, you get early access to all our episodes and patron-only episodes where you can ask me and Patricia MMT questions. We have no ads or sponsorship, so your financial support is the thing that keeps this show going. It puts food on the table, and your support in other ways, whether it's by recommending us to other people or by giving us a good rating or reviews on iTunes, those things really help too. As ever, thanks for all your support and the time you put into understanding MMT. This is part one of a two-part interview, and part two will be out next week. Let's dive in. Welcome one and all to the MMT podcast. I'm Christian Riley.
And I'm Patricia Pina.
And it's our pleasure to welcome to the show for the first time, Professor of Law at Cornell Law School, Professor Bob Hockett. Bob, it's great to have you on.
Hey guys, what a joy to be with you at last. I've been following you for a long time. Never thought I would actually meet the stars in person, but here we are. Great joy. Thanks so much.
It's our pleasure. Seeing as it's your first time, could you give our listeners a bit of background on how you came to monetary law and economics and MMT?
Yeah, sure. So believe it or not, I actually lived in your country for a while, particularly when I was a doctoral student. And most of my work in those days was in philosophy and mathematics. I was kind of a mathematical logic geek and loved the sets of questions that were sort of brought up by various paradoxes that came up in that discipline. But the problem with it was that it was sort of abstracted from actual life. And the world seemed to be sort of beginning to go to hell in a handcart at that point back in the early 90s. And I was beginning to feel increasingly guilty about the fact that I was working in a field that was, on the one hand, just immensely stimulating sort of intellectually for me, but didn't really seem to have much to say to the world. So that got me thinking about whether there might be some disciplinary track that I could pursue that would, on the one hand, enable me to sort of continue to sort of indulge that taste for formal rigor, I suppose, that I had back then, while on the other hand, maybe promising something helpful, you know, sort of to the world, something actually practical. So I applied to various doctoral programs in finance and economics, thinking that maybe that would be the route I would go. And so then I did end up starting to do that, and I finished all of the work other than the dissertation. But the thing was that in that field, right, in orthodox economics and finance, a lot of the rigor, for one thing, is really not that rigorous. It sort of looks rigorous because there's a lot of symbolism used, but it's actually conceptually or analytically not very rigorous at all, because the sort of foundational concepts that are employed are often themselves ill-defined or quite muddled, and it's indeed quite a scandal to the mind of anybody who's been logically trained, and again, sort of in contemporary mathematical logic in particular, to sort of see how unbelievably muddle-headed a lot of, again, the foundational ideas are. So I thought, you know what I should do? So first there was that, but then second, there was also the fact that the orthodoxy was kind of sterile as well, right? It was basically, it seemed almost like kind of high church apologetics for existing distributions of advantage and disadvantage, right? It seemed profoundly, in other words, it seemed like a kind of a sort of a high church pseudo-mathematized apologetic for injustice. I mean, just pervasive global injustice, right, all over the place. So I thought, I'm going to have to do a little bit of a rethink when it comes to writing the dissertation. So I stopped out for a while. I was nominally at Yale, and I went to work with a bunch of homeless folk under a bridge while I was sort of stopped out. I was sort of thinking through the dissertation, what I was ultimately going to write it on. And I started hanging out with these really interesting and enjoyable homeless, believe it or not, it sounds weird to say enjoyable, but enjoyable homeless guys. I mean, they're just really enjoyable to spend time with, right? They were just wonderful, lovely, beautiful people. And so I thought, you know, I want to hang out with these guys more and just sort of see if I can figure out why they're homeless and why, you know, how it came to pass in a kind of a micro way that they came to live as they live, right? I sort of felt like I had a kind of macro understanding as to what was happening globally to make this kind of thing possible in supposedly advanced nations or wealthy or well-to-do nations. But I kind of wanted to get a bit of a micro exposure as well. So I ended up living with these guys for about 3 years under the bridge. I kept my own place as well. So I basically would sort of sleep under the bridge as much as I could. But when I had to, I'd go back to my place to shower, things of that sort. Or if I had to get a good night's sleep some night for some event or something I had to do the following day, I would stay at my place. But largely, we just slept under the bridge with sleeping bags and the like. And it was quite a life. I'd done a lot of camping as a kid, so it was kind of, in that sense, sort of second nature. But two things that sort of emerged, and then I'll pause for breath. I really get excited about this stuff, and then I just don't shut up. But two things that emerged, I think, that sort of take us to where you guys are going, or where we're meant to be going in our conversation, about sort of why there were homeless were, A, they didn't have any sort of access to anything like banking or financial services. They were sort of, in effect, they didn't exist as far as the financial system was concerned, or the money or payments system was concerned, or the broader financial system. And that got me to thinking, you know, how odd it is. Right? We call ourselves a commercial exchange economy, but these guys have, it's a bit like being an automotive economy in Los Angeles, but not having a car. You know, there was no sort of on-ramp for these guys. And then the second thing I noticed was that, you know, their way of life, which had become sort of my way of life during the time that we were together, was a kind of, at least by American standards, a kind of pre-modern mode of existence, in the sense that it combined work with life. It was a sort of almost like tribal or village type existence, right? Where, because they worked harder than anybody I knew. And when I started working with them, I worked harder than I had ever worked. We would wash cars and do what was called detailing of cars. I can't remember whether there's a British equivalent expression, but here in the US we call it detailing, usually leaving off the G. And that just means basically cleaning and polishing and digging into the crevices in doing the cleaning of automobiles, both inside and out. And then, you know, so they would make oodles and oodles of money. And then we would go up, you know, in the evening and buy groceries to cook under the bridge together. A, they had no place to save the money, as noted before, and B, they couldn't replicate that kind of a life, right, where you combine sort of work with living together in any kind of graceful way in contemporary Western economies, certainly not in the contemporary American economy. And I thought maybe they find in some ways, even if only sort of subconsciously, this sort of American separation, this modern separation of work from life in that sort of radical way, sort of alienating. I mean, certainly I did, and I do. I mean, it's one reason I decided then why I ended up becoming an academic, is because when you're an academic, you do sort of combine work with life, right? You tend to socialize with your fellow scholars, you hang out together a lot, and you basically, there's a kind of a wholeness or a sort of totality to your life. Your life isn't sort of divvied up or sort of segmented into little pieces where you're with different people and during different chunks. So I thought that was another part of the story. And it struck me that what they had was a kind of kibbutz, right? They had sort of reinvented the idea of the kibbutz, at least as it was originally conceived and executed. You know, the contemporary kibbutz is quite different. But that got me to wondering, okay, A, why don't we have financial or banking or monetary or payment services availability for folks like my friends? And then B, why do we have the particular enterprise forms that we have? You know, the sort of the off-the-rack forms like the corporation or the limited liability company or the limited partnership or what have you. Why is it that those are the forms? And so I got to thinking that, well, that's sort of, those are sort of theoretical questions on the one hand, but they also have a very important sort of practical significance. So I decided in the end then that what I would do would be to go back and do the doctoral degree. Finish the doctoral degree, I should say, finish the dissertation, but only after first doing something that I had always thought of as anathema before, which was to get a law and or business degree, something vocational. Because I thought that way I would be able to learn a bit more about, you know, how institutions work and why we have the institutions that we have. And that's exactly what was missing from orthodox finance or orthodox economics. And as a sort of a side benefit, it would give me a kind of union card, as it were, to do legal work or business or financial work for my friends under the bridge and for sort of similarly situated folk. So I went back to Yale and I sort of reconstituted my dissertation committee into something that was partly economic and finance, but partly sort of justice theoretic and partly legal. So Robert Shiller, who was at Yale at the time, just as he is now, but this was before he got his Nobel, I asked to be one of my supervisors because he was doing sort of innovative financial derivatives design work. And I thought that's one thing I'd like to do, is to design derivatives that help ordinary folk rather than just, you know, back hats. And then John Romer, who was a very mathematically rigorous economist and theorist of justice, sort of often mentioned in the same breath with people like John Rawls or Ronnie Dworkin or Jerry Cohen and those folk, all with most of whom he was close friends. And then a fellow at the Yale Law School named Jerry Mashaw, who's both a legal scholar and had a doctoral degree in public administration and was sort of an expert then on how public agencies or executive agencies work. So these three were my principal dissertation advisors. And the work ended up being much more, I think, or at least I hope, institutionally enriched while sort of, I hope, theoretically rigorous. So I finished that and then ended up becoming an academic. And ever since then, I've been doing the kind of stuff that I do that you guys know about academically. But there's always, I've got this kind of other life that's always going on at the same time, which is the sort of practical existence, which involves doing a lot of consulting for legislators, government officials, a lot of legislative drafting as well, and then a fair bit of pro bono legal and financial work. In fact, I think one of my proudest accomplishments is to have helped win a case against Goldman Sachs, where Goldman settled with a pension fund that they had defrauded and had to pay up, you know, pretty good money. And it's kind of cool to be able to do that stuff and not have to, you know, not need pay for it. You know, you can just sort of choose your quote unquote clients or causes on their merits alone, because you've got, you know, basically a basic income that you can, you know, rely on in the form of the academic post. So that's a really long-winded, breathless way of answering what should have been probably a much more simply a much simpler answerable question. But anyway,
I bet that's made you really popular with the financiers. do you find that's kind of been an influence? Have you found any obstacles along the way because of that confrontation?
Yeah, such a great question, Patricia. So it's interesting. I mean, yes and no. On the one hand, there are the predictable enemies, so to speak, or antagonists, just as you would have thought. And sort of compounding the irony, by the way, of that is the fact that I actually live right on Wall Street. I live like 3 blocks from the New York Fed.
Keep your enemies close.
Precisely, right? Keep your friends close and your enemies closer. Right? I feel like that. I sometimes laugh that, you know, little do they know that, you know, Lev Trotsky is walking up the street right by them. Sort of being facetious, but I'm right here in the belly of that proverbial beast, because I came here actually to work at the New York Fed about 10 years ago. And so a lot of, you know, maybe needless to say, I'm in sort of hostile territory, you might say. There are plenty of people around me, physically at least, who probably would be very antagonistic if they knew who I was or what I was doing. But here's the thing that's a little bit more surprising. Over the last maybe 12 to 14 years, I've discovered the existence of a class of people whose existence I never would have imagined, you know, would ever be instantiated anywhere. And that's what I call just the sort of the radical investment banker or the radical financier. So, you know, you can sort of think of it as people who are sort of like what George Soros fancies himself as being, and to some extent is, right? I mean, in some ways, Soros is a progressive presence, and he does fund a lot of, I think, on balance, beneficial work and research and efforts and so forth, whatever misgivings we might have from time to time. But there are a lot of sort of lower profile, less well-known sort of radical financier types who I think are actually closer to what Soros wants to think of himself as being even than he is. And that was a sort of surprise to me, at least at first. But then over time, I sort of began to think, well, actually, it kind of makes a certain sense, because one thing that financiers know and sort of have exposure to that a lot of academic economists, probably, you know, probably the overwhelming majority of academic economists don't, is actual exposure to actual financial markets. They actually see how this shit works, right? And anybody who's actually watched this shit happening for more than about 8.5 minutes, we'll just tell you immediately that pretty much every orthodox economics textbook that's assigned you in your undergraduate economics courses or your graduate ones is just sheerest bullshit. It's basically just what sort of less articulately popped into my head when I first started doing that stuff as a sort of new doctoral student, which was that it's sort of pseudo rigorous, right? Again, it purports to be rigorous because it's all mathematized in a certain sense. And yet again, the foundational concepts that are used are just so ill considered and so sort of unreflectively formulated and adopted and then just used forever without ever being questioned again. So I imagine I invented something I just called the blind spaghetti monster, and then I just started building a discipline around it. And then, you know, for decades and decades, people just keep talking about the blind spaghetti monster without ever actually looking to see whether it could be found, even asking what the hell it was, you know? So anyway, that's, I think that a lot of the folk who have a significant market experience kind of come to see that really quickly. And that opens the door then to heterodoxies sort of lodging in the brains of some of them. And then those who have good hearts that haven't been thoroughly corrupted or, you know, irredeemably corrupted by their profession sort of begin to think, well, you know, if the markets don't actually work the way the economists say, and we actually have a lot more latitude to act collectively, to sort of reshape our productive arrangements, why the hell don't we? let's do it. So there's a sizable number of them. They're a tiny minority of all the financiers out there, I think, but nevertheless, it's a non-trivial number.
So you touched on it a little bit there, which is something that I'm really interested in and I haven't read enough about. It's the institutionalist side of MMT, like you say, you spent a little bit of time looking at it and straight away you're like, I actually need to know what is going on here. Like not the spaghetti monster story, but like what is really happening. And it's kind of what got you into, you know, what got you into that realm where you were like, okay, I'm going to study institutions.
Yeah. So you'll laugh. I mean, it's just sort of a weird, quirky accident in a way, but I guess a lot of life is. So I was like lots of people who go through periods where they're a little uncertain as to what they're doing and think they have to do a bit of a reset, which is what I had to do when I made the decision to stop out and then live with these homeless friends. I sort of for a while was feeling a bit like a freak, like, oh, you know, I started down this path and now I'm not sure it's the right path. And I must just be, you know, there must be something constitutionally ill-structured or sort of poorly put together or sort of miswired about me. And so I would sort of read around to sort of find out if there were other people who had kind of gone through this and then, you know, came out all right. And in the midst of all of this, I discovered an economist of all things, who you guys have, of course, heard about. I had never heard of him at the time, at least. And this is the old Swedish economist Knut Wicksell, who was active in the late 19th and early 20th century. And the reason that he intrigued me, I don't know what I read first that sort of brought this to my attention, but almost the first thing that was brought to my attention about him was what, you know, kind of made him grab my brain, which was that he had been a radical socialist journalist until he got into his 40s or 50s. And then decided to become an economist. And his background, his disciplinary background, was in pure mathematics. So I thought, and then I was raised by two Swedish grandparents. My mom and her parents immigrated to the States from Sweden. So I was raised by, so I sort of thought, oh, little superficial comparison there, right? You know, he's sort of, maybe he's a distant relative of mine. He comes into sort of, you know, economics late. I mean, in his case, it was even later than me. And he comes into it from a mathematical background. So I started, and also it's sort of radical pamphleteering journalist guy, you know, lefty journals, a kind of Matt Taibbi, perhaps, of late 19th century Sweden. So I read more about him and then read more of what he had to say. And one of the things that was absolutely utterly fascinating about his writing or his work, it seemed to me, was that he had noticed really early on that there is something that we now, that he dubbed bank money, and that nowadays is oftentimes called credit money. There are various other names that are used for it. But the basic idea, he had rediscovered something that the great British market observer Henry Thornton had noticed about 50 years earlier, which was the endogeneity of money. And in the role that private sector banking and financial institutions that are sort of in one way or another backed up by sovereigns play in generating the endogenous money supply. And as far as Wicksell was concerned, that changes everything, right? It explains so much. And it also, not only does it explain much that happens in the way of sort of bubble and bust or sort of crazy cycling behavior, but it also suggests, or at least opens the door to a kind of more forthright, a more sort of reflective, deliberate, collective use of what ultimately, you know, has to be viewed as a public resource, which is what I think is just basically finance capital or investment capital. If you think about it, in a monetary exchange economy, capital takes monetary form, and if that money is generated by publicly backed endogenous money generating banking institutions, well, then in effect, the greater part of our investment capital supply is public capital. And that in turn, that means that, well, the public ought to be able to control that and use it and deploy it productively instead of merely speculatively. So I started thinking in terms of, I call it now the capital commons, basically. There's a sort of commons in capital. And I got a lot of work coming out of, sort of in that, along those lines shortly, but a lot of the past work is in the same vein. But in any event, that's how I kind of came into this. Later then I learned that, well, okay, Vixel sort of had a very strange post-life history, my posthumous history. The Austrians, of course, adopted him, or adopted and adapted him, but they, of course, put him to really pernicious use. I mean, they basically got the description. I think the Austrians are very, very much correct descriptively about how many works, because they're basically just all Vixelians. Their problem is that there is with the prescriptions rather than the descriptions, right? I guess because they come from Austria, which is the land of the Oedipus complex and Freud, and also bungling Habsburg Empire and then bungling fascist government. They're sort of suspicious of collective agency and collective. But the so-called Swedish school, which I think of as sort of the Austrian school without the Oedipus complex, it was actually been really smart about this stuff. And this is one reason that Sweden has tended to do quite well as far as the sort of egalitarian spread of social advantage that's all publicly financed is concerned. They're the better Austrians, you might say. There's an irony here too, because I remember I noted that my mom is from Sweden and my father's from Austria. So, I think it was inevitable, right, that I would sort of find this stuff interesting, but also my mom left my father, so it was, oh, God. I mean, this is all purely accidental.
Did anybody end up blinded? That's
a great question. No, but I still haven't been thrown off the cliff yet. Maybe I will.
Oh, sorry, we were talking about your actual life here. We shouldn't be.
but so that's what I think. That's what opened me up to being. I mean, first of all, I found Keynes's treatise on money congenial, because he's just channeling Vixel and says so. He's sort of discovering Vixel for the Anglosphere about 30 years late, later than everybody else. And then a lot of my sort of MMT friends, of course, come out of the tradition of Keynes's treatise on money. So I think that a lot of my MMT friends, I think, are Vixelian without quite realizing it. Although it's also possible that they're a little less Vixelian than I am, because most of them seem to be much more focused on the public the public role than on the sort of private sector role, where the private sector has been sort of delegated public powers and so forth. And so the angle from which they come at things is a little different from the angle that I tend to, but we nevertheless always seem to end up, or almost always seem to end up, in the same place.
That brings us really nicely on to, you have a great explanation of how the banking system in the US evolved in the 1800s to what we've got today. And I think it really helps people understand, people who might be confused about endogenous money. I think it really helps people understand why we are where we are, and how endogenous money sits with MMT. Do you think you could run through that?
Yeah, definitely. So it's kind of fun to kind of compare it to the contemporaneous UK financial system and the sort of earlier UK financial system out of which both sort of developed or evolved. So the thing about, as you guys know better than I probably, in the UK, the sort of the dominant form of money in the financial markets, particularly in the 19th century, was what's known as the bill of exchange. And the bill of exchange really was the endogenous money of the time. This was the kind of money that Marx referred to also as fictitious capital. So a lot of people think that Marx was somehow a metalist or some kind of weird, like, retro money type guy. But that's just because the word money back in the 19th century was reserved to specie, right, to sort of metal or metal-based money, whereas things like bills of exchange, which were the actual principal circulating medium, just weren't called money, even though functionally speaking, that's what they were. So in any event, as you guys know, Walter Badgett, kind of nicely sort of encapsulated the role that the public sector can play, or that a central bank at least can play, in sort of backing up endogenously generated credit money that took form in the UK of bills of exchange. And so he, if you combine him with Henry Thornton, you can say that you kind of had all the makings of a full understanding of the sort of interactions between public and private in generating endogenous money which can then be put to good use, but can also be, you know, overissued and hence lead to all sorts of mischief and so forth. Now, here in the U.S., we had the potential, we had the capacity, in a sense, to understand these things and to learn them from observations of the UK, partly because we ourselves had experienced the UK version of it, let's say the 18th century UK version of it, along with the 18th century UK, because, you know, in the very early days of our republic, we were basically imitating the UK. So Hamilton's First Bank of the US, which was a kind of combined Fed slash development bank, was patterned expressly after the Bank of England and the functions that it had. And Hamilton was very well aware of the fact that the money supply is largely endogenously generated and that the public sector plays a critical role in doing that generating. Because again, this is what the Bank of England was doing at the time. And we actually saw great growth that was more or less stable growth for the first 20, 25 years of the Republic, thanks to Hamilton's first bank and then its successor, the Second Bank of the U.S. that was run by Albert Gallatin, who ironically had been a great nemesis of Hamilton's, but then became more Hamiltonian even than Hamilton once he actually sat in the same position that Hamilton sat in. In any event, the Yahoos kind of took over with Andrew Jackson in the late 1820s. And as you guys know, Jackson sort of famously vetoed the renewal of the Second Bank of the U.S. So we went without any sort of federal banking presence, let alone any sort of central bank, for a good nearly half century up to the mid-1860s. And during that time, which is, I think, what you were alluding to before, Christian, the primary circulating medium was, again, endogenous, but it was generated by all of these distinct private sector banking institutions, very few of which were well regulated or well sort of overseen or supervised. This was the so-called wildcat banking era, sort of euphemistically referred to as the free banking era. And sure, some of these banks were well run. Some of them operated above board. Some of them were quite well regulated if they were chartered in states that were sort of serious about things, primarily in New England. But a lot of them, probably the greater part of them, were formed in states that didn't really have good state capacity yet and didn't really know how to regulate banks or, you know, sort of oversee banking systems very well. And so they tended, you know, regularly to overissue their own paper banknotes, which were the circulating medium of the time. And so we went through these kind of crazy boom and bust cycles all the time because of this sort of tendency to overgenerate, to overissue banknotes. That's not even to mention the lack of uniformity problem, right? The fact that different currencies traded at different discounts from par, meaning that merchants and others who basically were paid in these currencies had to maintain these little catalog type books with lists of all of these different issuances and the discount rate that was meant to apply, the discount from par that was meant to apply to all of them. So it didn't really facilitate smooth transacting. And if you consider how the, you know, it's sort of ironic too, right? Because as you know, the orthodox story of money is that, well, it's developed as a transaction cost saving medium. Mm-hmm. Well, that would be a pretty funny thing for it to be created for if the dominant forms back when it was first generated in that way were, you know, constantly wildly fluctuating relative to one another. I think barter would probably be more efficient. But in any event, so for, you know, fast forwarding, when the Civil War breaks out, you know, we've got a union up north of the Mason-Dixon line trying to suppress a secessionist rebellion to the south. So, you know, we have to muster armies. We have to arm them. We have to clothe them, uniform them, purchase materials, so forth. It sort of doesn't really, I mean, basically a wildcat currency system doesn't really lend itself to sort of effective public expenditure, let alone public mobilization for war. So Congress basically passes three enactments in rapid succession that President Lincoln signs into law. And what they jointly give us is, first of all, a nationally issued paper currency, a nationally issued banknote, so to speak. It was referred to as the greenback, and we still have the same color, of course. And a system of nationally chartered banks, which issue these notes. And then finally, a regulator or sort of a a federal instrumentality that sits atop these nationally licensed banks that we still have to this day as one of our three principal banking regulators, called the Officer of the Comptroller of the Currency, or OCC. Now, contemporarily, people think, why is there a regulator with a weird name like that? What does that mean? Comptroller, it sounds like something, I don't know, something like from a railroad from the 1820s or something. What does that mean? But it actually has a very straightforward meaning when one remembers what the purpose of the enactment itself was on the one hand, and the, you know, the etymology of the word comptroller on the other, which is just a sort of archaic English word for controller. So the idea was that this office of our Treasury Department would control the currency, would literally control the currency. And why wouldn't it? It was issuing it, after all, right? And it would control it by controlling the banks that you could sort of think of as franchisees, in a sense, of this product that the public itself was producing, namely the dollar. And just like any franchise arrangement, this one was sort of a quality control arrangement too, right? The franchisor, or the OCC, is ensuring that these private sector institutions that are licensed to propagate or to disseminate this product, the dollar, we're doing it according to sound principles, right? And so at that point, the money becomes forthrightly public and forthright in, or the credit money supply. And the endogeneity now is less problematic because you can control it as long as the comptroller is doing his or her job, right? So that worked out. It was certainly an improvement on prior arrangements. But then just to fast forward, I'll stop in a second. The one thing we still didn't quite fully get, or, you know, at least as a polity, was that you need your currency not only to be sort of controllable and uniform, but ideally you want it to be sort of what I call modulatable. The sort of term of art that's often used is it should be an elastic currency. And by that we simply mean that the supply of it can be sort of fine-tuned in a kind of quick, you know, sort of on a dime way, even on a daily basis if need be. And that's what central banks are especially well situated to do. But what the Treasury Department, even through the OCC, was not really well situated to do. So founding the Federal Reserve in 1913, basically sort of completed the reconstruction, you might say, of the original Hamiltonian system. Because the Federal Reserve System that we put in place in 1913 now was able to modulate the money supply in a very fine-tuned way on a daily basis. Now it does it on a hourly basis, and was also a kind of development bank, like Hamilton's first bank of the U.S. So not only did it issue the circulating medium, as Hamilton's bank did, but it was also a sort of development bank, which is, of course, the way to explain another weird feature of our system that people sort of find weird because they don't know the origins of it, and because it itself has sort of forgotten its own origins, but that is the two-tiered status of the Fed, right? So the regional Fed banks. And everybody wonders, what do they do now? My research assistant, as the great discussion, said, don't they just write papers and stuff? I said, yeah, that's right. I said, yeah, unfortunately, that's all they do now. But
papers as in research papers.
Yeah, research papers, exactly. But what they were originally established to do was to function as regional development banks, regional development finance institutions that would sort of that were sort of designed to be sort of responsive to differing regional conditions across the still developing U.S. economy in the early 20th century. We've sort of lost sight of that original mission, but weirdly, they keep doing the research that originally they started doing in order to aid them in making those sorts of regional lending decisions. But anyway, so that's sort of how we got to where we are now. And as you guys know, one thing I sort of do a lot these days is I sort of play up the analogy between, you know, kind of what I call wildcat crypto, all these sort of different issuers of crypto assets and the like. And I think, in effect, these are just the digital versions of the old wildcat banknotes. And my guess is that they're in for the same future, that we will ultimately digitize the dollar and run it out of the Fed.
Part of what you're advocating for at the moment is it would be good if citizens could have accounts at the Fed. Do you want to maybe say what you've got now and what you want to move to?
So I think that ultimately we want the Fed to be issuing wallets to all citizens, businesses, and guests, or, you know, residents, people with green cards and the like. And those would be people's, that would be at least one kind of quote-unquote bank account that people would have for using what I tend to call the democratic digital dollar, or the 3D. And so that would be on the liability side of the Fed balance sheet. That would correspond to a new set of assets that would be on the asset side of the Fed balance sheet. These assets would be productive loans, loans that would be extended by the Fed, by the regional Feds in a revived regional Fed development bank role for productive development in the real economies of the regions of the country. And if you want, we could talk a bit more about that in a moment. But I mention it now just because it helps in sort of setting the stage for what I'm sort of viewing or sort of thinking about in connection with the wallets. So one way to think about, if we think about the public itself as having a balance sheet, you know, the whole public sector say has a bank, a balance sheet. And let's imagine this as a sort of central bank balance sheet. Well, the Fed right now, on the liability side of the balance sheet, maintains all of these reserve accounts for private sector banking institutions, right? And those accounts are liabilities of the Fed and assets of the banks in the same way that your and my bank accounts at a bank are liabilities of the bank and assets of us, right? Now, what I'm sort of thinking we should do is, well, okay, so the second thing is, what that means is that in a certain sense, all of our bank accounts are also Fed liabilities, but sort of one step removed. So they don't get counted as Fed liabilities because of that removal step. So there's a kind of there's a sense in which, if you think in terms of parental terms, you might say the Fed is the grandparent, the banks are the parents, and we're the kids, you know. Now, if we imagine cutting out the parent layer, and so now I'm going back to my autobiography because my grandparents raised me and I was my mom's brother functionally, but I swear it doesn't really all come from that. You know, it's just, I just notice these weird parallels, but in any event, imagine taking a big chunk of those private sector bank accounts off of the bank books, just cutting out the middleman, so to speak, cutting out the parental layer, and just putting them directly on the Fed the liability of the Fed balance sheet. In effect, functionally speaking, it's sort of the same situation. It's still ultimately a Fed liability, but now it's more transparently so because it's right there on the Fed balance sheet. Furthermore, you've taken out the middleman, meaning all of those abusive practices in the form of fees and so forth are gone. That in turn means everybody can be banked. Basically, it would be a birthright or a citizen right, a citizenship right, or a duly incorporated or organized business right, or again, a green card right to have one of these wallets. Now, think about what else that would mean. Not only would you take care of the sort of financial and commercial exclusion problem that my friends under the bridge had, you would also have a much more effective medium of monetary policy. You take the leakage out, because by working through these middleman institutions right now, there's just immense leakage, right? The way the Fed stimulates through monetary policy is by basically just making money cheaper, more cheaply available to the banks, and then it just kind of hopes that they'll lend more of it to the citizenry. But A, why should we just have to hope that? And B, why should it have to be lent? Why don't we just give it in some cases, at least when it's not going to be inflationary? So in effect, what you could do is you could do monetary policy much more effectively, especially if you offer interest on these wallet accounts, right? So basically, you raise rates if things are overheating and you want people to save more. You lower rates if you want to do the contrary. If things get really desperate, you can do digital helicopter drops directly into people's wallets. It's all just beautiful, right? And all of our problems right now, it seems to be, at least on that side of things, are attributable to the indirection on the one hand and the sort of associated lack of transparency on the other hand. So that would be on the liability side. So in effect, what we're doing is we're augmenting the liability side of the Fed balance sheet, but only in a very restricted sense of the word augmentation here. We're just basically saying a lot of stuff that is currently indirectly on the Fed, on the liability side of the balance sheet, we're going to put directly smack dab in the middle on that side. Now, as you guys know, of course, corresponding to liabilities are always assets. So what would be the counterpart for sort of augmenting the asset side of the Fed balance sheet? Well, here's where this idea of sort of reviving that old development bank role of the regional Feds comes in. This is a proposal I have out on the one hand independently, and on the other hand as part of a bigger thing. The independent version of this I just call spread the Fed. Sort of spread, the idea is to sort of spread the Fed's functionality again over the regional Fed banks as it once was. So what you would do is this. You'd say, okay, look, private sector banking institutions, which generate endogenous money, suffer a particular problem that for some reason, I mean, it really is ought to be accessible to orthodox intuition. And, you know, even in other words, you don't have to be heterodox to see this. And yet the orthodox folk just never seem to notice it or talk about it. But and that is that basically the way once you have a monetary exchange economy on the one hand, and then secondary, tertiary, NRE, and derivatives markets on the other hand, there's no necessary link between profiting and producing, right? Profits and production are severable now, right? Furthermore, it's almost guaranteed that they are going to be severed once they become severable for a couple of reasons. And all of them sound in what I think of as sort of collective action predicaments, right? So, and so, as you guys know, a sort of orthodox collective action problem is a situation where multiple acts of individual rationality aggregate into sort of collectively irrational outcomes. Well, if you think in terms of production and the interest in producing, it's really easy, I think, to see why our process of production, if it is subject to financing through private sector decentralized private sector financial markets, is bound to be dysfunctional, because most productive projects take a while to sort of pan out. They take a while to sort of show returns, so to speak. And furthermore, a lot of the good that they generate is so-called, you know, externalities that can't be privately captured anyway. So as soon as opportunities emerge to sort of gamble on price movements in secondary or tertiary markets, and thereby, you know, win returns quickly rather than having to wait by investing so-called patient capital. As soon as those sorts of opportunities emerge, it's all but inevitable that an awful lot of money is going to be diverted essentially to the betting behavior. And while that can, at the front end, at the very beginning, can be justified as sort of hedging away some of the risk that attends decentralized, privately ordered production, it doesn't take long before it becomes the tail that wags the dog, as they say, or as our friend J.M. Keynes put it in Chapter 12, the foam on the surface of the water becomes more voluminous than the water itself. All of that, I think, is the product of, on the one hand, these what I call recursive collective action predicaments, just the fact that it's individually rational for people to bet instead of invest, on the one hand, and the endogeneity of the money that they do the betting with on the other. So it seems to me the way to solve this problem is you say, okay, we're going to distinguish between public capital and private capital. Private capital is money, so to speak, or wealth that has been indeed pre-accumulated. In other words, it's the deposits that make loans, according to the old sort of intermediation myth. Insofar as there are such deposits that precede loans, fine, you know, knock yourselves out, do whatever the fuck you want with it, right? But insofar as we're talking about money in accounts that finds its way into the accounts as a result of the lending activity, where the loans make the deposits rather than the other way around, call that public capital and say private sector banks are not going to be able to invest that public capital. Instead, what they have to do is, I mean, at least they're not going to be able to do it sort of in a way that isn't sort of ex ante pre-approved, right, by the regional feds. So the way it would work would be this. You've got private sector enterprises, businesses in various regions throughout the country that have interesting business plans or business ideas or business expansion plans or whatever. They seek funding from either directly from the federal, from a regional Fed bank, by selling various forms of short-term paper, which used to be sold to those banks in the early part of the 20th century. Or they seek loans from private sector banks, but the private sector banks have to get loans from the Fed first. So they have to go to the regional feds and say, we'd like to finance these particular projects. They look promising to us for the following reasons. And they have to make the case that these would be productive projects, not merely profitable projects. In other words, profit isn't enough, right? Profit might be necessary. We could argue with that too, but let's assume for the sake of argument that we want everything to be profitable. You could still say not all profitable. You could say only profitable projects that are also going to be productive. And so then what that would mean is that you'd have a bunch of additional assets now on the asset side of the Fed balance sheet, namely that paper that they purchase from those private sector firms that they're financing at the regional level, or from private sector banks that they extend loans to, so that those private sector banks can then fund those kinds of projects. And what I'm thinking is that that new class of assets on the asset side of the Fed balance sheet would basically just be the asset side counterpart to these new liability side things called these wallet accounts. And so, in effect, what you've got is a kind of mutual augmentation of both sides of the Fed balance sheet. But another way to think about this is you're just sort of taking one big chunk of activity that has both asset and liability aspects to it out of the private sector and putting it onto the Fed balance sheet, just making it public instead. And it seems to me that that's a sensible way of doing things, because then what you're doing is just basically saying publicly, you're going to have public management of public capital. Basically, all the endogenous money is public capital, we'll say. So public management of public capital, private management of private capital. Now, here's a really cool last thing on this, and I'll stop again for a second. You can sort of think about this as sort of, at least I tend to think of this as sort of what Irving Fisher and his 100% money proposal back in the 1930s, and all of the so-called narrow banking retreads of Fisher's original vision that have been sort of proffered in the last 10 or 15 years. This is sort of what those things should have been, seems to me. In effect, I think what Fisher understood and what all of the retread profferers understand is that we should have in place a kind of a thou shalt not when it comes to the private management of public capital. In effect, when you say 100% banking, you're saying, okay, we're going to make banks be what they always falsely claim to be. That is to say, intermediaries. They're only going to be allowed to lend out what they actually already have antecedently brought in the form of pre-accumulated deposits. So in other words, we're going to make it the case that deposits make loans, rather than allowing it also to be the case that loans make deposits. That's all seems to be sound, right? But where I think where Fisher came a cropper is exactly where all of the sort of latter-day retreads, including Kolpakovs and Cochran's and all these other sort of recent versions, come a cropper, which is they have the thou shalt not right, but you can't do the thou shalt not unless you also accompany it with a thou shalt, which is the public lending part of it. And the reason it's easy to see why that's the case if you just sort of meditate for a half a second on, you know, J.M. Keynes's very polite response to Irving Fisher when Fisher invited him to sign on to his 100% money plan back in the 30s. So Keynes said, "It's a brilliant idea. Everything you ever think of is brilliant. You're a genius. I love it. I love it. I do think, however, that, you know, being in the midst of a debt deflation, as we are, it might not be an opportune time to adopt an inherently deflationary policy, which is what your proposal would do." And that's just sort of a polite way of saying
really that. Really polite, yeah.
It's like if you're going to take the endogeneity completely out of money, well, then basically you're just going to throw us back into subsistence level production. You might as well not have money at all if you're going to take the endogeneity out of it. The key is not to get rid of the endogeneity; it's to socialize the endogeneity, right? Mm-hmm. And I think Keynes understood that. Yeah, doesn't that sounds kind of right? Right?
Yeah, it sounds great.
And as you guys know, I mean, Keynes kind of toyed with thoughts along these lines, but he never really developed them. So another way of thinking of what I'm doing, I guess, is I'm trying to do an American version of what Keynes, I think, was kind of inchoately looking for, kind of groping towards. So there were these kind of cryptic remarks you might remember toward the end of the general theory, where he talks about the euthanasia of the rentier, and then talks about the possible need for a socialization of investment. But then he doesn't really say much about what that might look like or what that might be. Now, there's a clue to what he might have meant in the work that he wrote, or co-wrote at least, I think 8 to 10 years earlier. So, you know, back when the Liberal Democrats and the Social, no, was it the Liberal Party? What was David Lloyd George's party? Were they just the Liberals, or were they the Liberal SDP back then? I can't remember. Back in the 20s.
I think they would have just been the Liberals at that point. I think the SDP came along much later, yeah.
Way later in the 70s or something.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So Keynes, you guys might know that back in the mid-20s, you know, Britain's depression came before the American one, and Britain was sort of coming out of its by the time the Americans collapsed into theirs. But so in the midst of the British version of the Great Depression in the 20s, the Liberal Party put out something called the Yellow Book. It's actually orange. I've got a copy of it. And it's titled Britain's Industrial Future. And there's a chapter in there on that Keynes was the primary author of, even though it doesn't say it was just written by him, but I think he took the lead role in drafting that chapter. And in that chapter, they lay out or discuss the possibility of establishing what Keynes called a Board of National Investment, or BNI. So in effect, it would be a kind of, it was sort of like industrial policy, but with public funded, public funding or public financing. I tend to think of that as a kind of proto-version of what the socialization of investment might look like. Interestingly enough, sort of contemporaneously here in the U.S., just shortly thereafter, we established an institution called the Reconstruction Finance Corporation, which is just basically a gigantic public investment bank. And in effect, it simply was an expansion of an earlier institution established by Woodrow Wilson during the First World War to help finance the U.S. mobilization when we entered the war, called the War Finance Corporation. But in a way, our RFC was a kind of, you could almost think of it as an American version of what Keynes might have had in mind with the BNI, and in a sense, a kind of a latter-day version of Hamilton's first Bank of the U.S., and in some ways a kind of anticipator of what I'm proposing, although what I'm proposing now is actually much more sort of far-flung and ambitious, I think, even than the RFC was. But in any event, getting back to what we were talking about then, and back to the line that Patricia liked, I think if we think seriously about what socializing the endogenous element of the money supply would look like and be, then we can have the 100% money idea in place. We can do narrow banking, because then what we just say is, yeah, narrow banking for private capital, public banking for public capital, you know. Mm-hmm. Problem solved, seems to me, right? Yeah. But, you know, we're so allergic to the idea of the public sector playing a role in allocation, yeah. Right? We say, oh, picking winners and losers, you know, but we pick winners and losers all the time, and we should get over it, man. I mean, that's such a Blairite or Clintonian thing, you know, picking winners and losers.
How many businesses like that get private funding all the time? Do they fail in the first year or something? There's like quite a big statistic.
I mean, every winner in this economy was picked. I mean, for fuck's sake. I mean, you know, why not? But anyway, I think we have to get a little bit smarter about that and stop being, you know, kind of, you know, sort of a theoretical point, by the way, sort of a side matter, but it's very much implicated. Is one way to, I mean, in the very early work that I did sort of academically in response to the sort of crash of 08 and so forth, I thought really an important thing to do that thinkers and academics, writers and central bankers weren't doing was distinguishing between two functions that I call the sort of money modulatory or modulation function on the one hand, and the money allocative function on the other, right? So the modulation just has to do with what's the size of the aggregate, and in particular, what's the size of the aggregate relative to the goods and services that could absorb that aggregate. That's the modulatory function. And then the allocative function is sort of where does it go? You know, where does the aggregate get sent or sort of distributed or whatever? Now, the reason I thought it was important to distinguish between those two things was not in order to try to, you know, separate them in sort of regulatory practice or whatever, but in order to kind of clarify our thoughts about what we're actually doing with various policies that various financial regulators follow or adopt. I think one way to describe our biggest mistake over the last 50 years plus in probably the entire West, but certainly in the Anglo-American West, is we seem to have had this idea that you can somehow modulate without allocating. In other words, we've treated these two things as if they were practically orthogonal, which they're not, right? They might be conceptually or analytically separable in the sense that you can think about them separately. You can ask, how much is there? And then you can ask, well, where is it going? What's the distribution of it? But as a practical matter, if you're misallocating, you're all but certain, I think, to undermodulate, you know, to modulate poorly. We basically misallocated all of this extra capital in this country into the mortgage markets, you know, over the 90s and early 2000s. And that just generated a hyperinflation in those markets, even ironically during the so-called Great Moderation, when we apparently, you know, we're told we didn't have inflation. So I think that a key lesson that maybe we still have to learn. I mean, well, it's funny, before, I mean, in the lead up to 08, we had forgotten about both, right? So Greenspan said you can't spot a bubble in the making, just got to wait for it to burst and then you clean up. That was the old lean versus clean debate. You could say that the leaners understood the modulatory imperative and the cleaners didn't. So back in 08, we had neither modulation nor allocation on the Fed agenda. So I devoted a lot of my own sort of scholarly time or scholarly bandwidth or whatever to trying to convince people like Greenspan and others that you can indeed modulate, which is just to say that you can sort of spot it coming in advance. Vixel, interestingly, had really great things to say on this. I mean, he offered a lot of clues as to how to spot stuff like this happening and thus how to modulate and that you can modulate. That battle was ultimately, in a certain sense, won in the sense that, you know, finally people began talking about macroprudential regulation again, and the word countercyclical suddenly became part of the English language again here in the States. And so I thought, oh, great. Okay, now we've got the modulatory task acknowledged. We've got Yellen instead of Greenspan, and Yellen sort of agreed you can modulate. But I thought, now for the hard part. Now we have to show them that you can't really get the modulation right if you don't get the allocation right. And we're still, this is sort of next, you know, phase two, so to speak. And that's the big capital commons project I'm working on now. I can send you guys some stuff on it if you're interested.
Yes, please.
Yeah,
it's all about that. Spread the Fed and the capital commons are all about getting allocation right with a view to getting modulation right, and thus to getting production and national development right, including equitable, sort of broadly inclusive production and development.
That was the MMT podcast with Patricia Pino and Christian Riley. Don't forget, you can support the show through Patreon, starting at $1 a month, and get access to patron-only episodes. You can do that by going to patreon.com/MMT podcast. You can also find me on Twitter at MMT podcast, and you can find Patricia on Twitter at Patricia N. Pino. And you can email us at mmtpodcast@outlook.com. Thanks for listening, and we hope to hear from you.